This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, The Regent. Author, Arnold Bennett. Part 1. Chapter 1, Dog Bite. 1. And yet, Edward Henry Machen reflected as at 6 minutes to 6 he approached his own dwelling at the top of Bleakridge, and yet, I don't feel so jolly after all. The first two words of this disturbing meditation had reference to the fact that, by telephoning twice to his stockbrokers at Manchester, he had just made the sum of £341 in a purely speculative transaction concerning rubber shares. It was in the autumn of the great gambling year, 1910. He had simply opened his lucky and wise mouth at the proper moment, and the money, like ripe golden fruit, had fallen into it, a gift from benign heaven, surely a cause for happiness. And yet, he did not feel so jolly. He was surprised, he was even a little hurt, to discover by introspection that monetary gain was not necessarily accompanied by felicity. Nevertheless, this very successful man of the world of the Five Towns, having been born on the 27th of May 1867, had reached the age of 43.5 years. "I must be getting older," he reflected. He was right. He was still young, as every man of 43 will agree, but he was getting older. A few years ago, a windfall of £341 would not have been followed by morbid self-analysis. It would have been followed by unreasoning instinctive elation, which elation would have endured at least 12 hours. As he disappeared within the reddish garden wall which sheltered his abode from the publicity of Trafalgar Road, he half hoped to see Nellie waiting for him on the famous marble step of the porch, for the woman had long, long since invented a way of scouting for his advent from the small window in the bathroom. But there was nobody on the marble step. His melancholy increased. At the midday meal, he had complained of neuralgia, and hence this was an evening upon which he might fairly have expected to see Sympathy charmingly attired in the porch. It is true that the neuralgia had completely gone. "Still," he said to himself with justifiable sardonic gloom, "how does she know my neuralgia's gone?" "She doesn't know." Having opened the front door, with the thinnest, neatest latch key in the Five Towns, he entered his home and stumbled slightly over a brush that was lying against the sunk doormat. He gazed at that brush with resentment. It was a dilapidated hand brush. The offensive object would have been out of place, at nightfall, in the lobby of any house. But in the lobby of his house, the house which he had planned a dozen years earlier, to the special end of minimizing domestic labor, and which he had always kept up to date with the latest devices, in his lobby, the spectacle of a vile, outworn hand brush at tea time amounted to a scandal. Less than a fortnight previously, he had purchased and presented to his wife a marvelous electric vacuum cleaner surpassing all former vacuum cleaners. "You simply attached this machine by a cord to the wall like a dog, and waved it in mysterious passes over the floor like a fan, and the house was clean." He was as proud of this machine as though he had invented it, instead of having merely bought it. Every day he inquired about its feats, expecting enthusiastic replies as a sort of reward for his own keenness, and be it said that he had had enthusiastic replies. And now this obscene hand brush. As he carefully removed his hat and his beautiful new Melton overcoat, which had the color and the soft smoothness of a damson, he animadverted upon the astounding negligence of women. There were Nellie, his wife, his mother, the nurse, the cook, the maid, 5 of them, and in his mind they had all plotted together, a conspiracy of carelessness, to leave the inexcusable tool in his lobby for him to stumble over. What was the use of accidentally procuring £341? Still no sign of Nellie, though he purposely made a noisy rattle with his ebon walking stick. Then the maid burst out of the kitchen with a tray, and the principal utensils for high tea thereon. She had a guilty air. The household was evidently late. 2 steps at a time he rushed upstairs to the bathroom, so as to be waiting in the dining room at 6 precisely in order, if possible, to shame the household and fill it with remorse and unpleasantness. Yet ordinarily he was not a very prompt man, nor did he delight in giving pain. On the contrary, he was apt to be casual, blithe, and agreeable. The bathroom was his peculiar domain, which he was always modernizing, and where his talent for the ingenious organization of comfort and his utter indifference to aesthetic beauty had the fullest scope. By universal consent, admitted to be the finest bathroom in the Five Towns, it typified the whole house. He was disappointed on this occasion to see no untidy trace in it of the children's ablution, some transgression of the supreme domestic law that the bathroom must always be free and immaculate when father wanted it would have suited his gathering humor. As he washed his hands and cleansed his well-trimmed nails with a nail brush that had cost 5 shillings and 6 pence, he glanced at himself in the mirror which he was splashing. A stoutish, broad-shouldered, fair, chubby man, with a short bright beard and plenteous bright hair. His necktie pleased him, the elegance of his turned-back wristbands pleased him, and he liked the rich down on his forearms. He could not believe that he looked 43 and a half. And yet he had recently had an idea of shaving off his beard, partly to defy time, but partly also, I must admit, because a friend had suggested to him, wildly perhaps, that if he dispensed with a beard his hair might grow more sturdily. Yes, there was one weak spot in the middle of the top of his head, where the crop had of late disconcertingly thinned. The hairdresser had informed him that the symptom would vanish under electric massage, and that, if he doubted the bona fides of hairdressers, any doctor would testify to the value of electric massage. But now Edward Henry Machen, strangely discouraged, inexplicably robbed of the zest of existence, decided that it was not worthwhile to shave off his beard. Nothing was worthwhile. If he was 43 and a half, he was 43 and a half. To become bald was the common lot. Moreover, beardless, he would need the service of a barber every day. And he was absolutely persuaded that not a barber worth the name could be found in the Five Towns. He actually went to Manchester, 36 miles, to get his hair cut. The operation never cost him less than a sovereign and half a day's time. And he honestly deemed himself to be a fellow of simple tastes. Such is the effect of the canker of luxury. Happily, he could afford these simple tastes, for although not rich in the modern significance of the term, he paid income tax on some £5,000 a year, without quite convincing the surveyor of taxes that he was an honest man. He brushed the thick hair over the weak spot, he turned down his wristbands, he brushed the collar of his jacket, and lastly his beard, and he put on his jacket, with a certain care, for he was very neat. And then, reflectively twisting his mustache to military points, he spied through the smaller window to see whether the new high hoarding of the football ground really did prevent a serious observer from descrying wayfarers as they breasted the hill from Hanbridge. It did not. Then he spied through the larger window upon the yard, to see whether the wall of the new rooms which he had lately added to his house showed any further trace of damp, and whether the new chauffeur was washing the new motor car with all his heart. The wall showed no further trace of damp, and the new chauffeur's bent back seemed to symbolize an extreme conscientiousness. Then the clock on the landing struck 6, and he hurried off to put the household to open shame. 2. Nellie came into the dining room 2 minutes after her husband. As Edward Henry had laboriously counted these 2 minutes almost second by second on the dining room clock, he was very tired of waiting. His secret annoyance was increased by the fact that Nellie took off her white apron in the doorway and flung it hurriedly onto the table tray which, during the progress of meals, was established outside the dining room door. He did not actually witness this operation of undressing, because Nellie was screened by the half-closed door, but he was entirely aware of it. He disliked it, and he had always disliked it. When Nellie was at work, either as a mother or as the owner of certain fine silver ornaments, he rather enjoyed the wonderful white apron, for it suited her temperament, but as the head of a household with £6,000 a year at its disposal, he objected to any hint of the thing at meals. And tonight, he objected to it altogether. Who could guess from the homeliness of their family life that he was in a position to spend £100 a week and still have enough income left over to pay the salary of a town clerk or so? Nobody could guess, and he felt that people ought to be able to guess. When he was young, he would have esteemed an income of £6,000 a year as necessarily implicating feudal state, valets, castles, yachts, family solicitors, racing stables, county society, dinner calls, and a drawling London accent. Why should his wife wear an apron at all? But the sad truth was that neither his wife nor his mother ever looked rich, or even endeavored to look rich. His mother would carry an 80-pound sealskin, as though she had picked it up at a jumble sale, and his wife put such simplicity into the wearing of a 180-pound diamond ring that its expensiveness was generally quite wasted. And yet, while the logical male in him scathingly condemned this feminine defect of character, his private soul was glad of it, for he well knew that he would have been considerably irked by the complexities and grandeurs of high life. But never would he have admitted this. Nellie's face as she sat down was not limpid. He understood naught of it. More than 20 years had passed since they had first met, he and a wistful little creature at a historic town hall dance. He could still see the wistful little creature in those placid and pure features, in that buxom body, but now there was a formidable, capable, and experienced woman there too. Impossible to credit that the wistful little creature was 37. But she was. Indeed, it was very doubtful if she would ever see 38 again. Once he had had the most romantic feelings about her. He could recall the slim flexibility of her waist, the timorous melting invitation of her eyes. And now, such was human existence. She sat up erect on her chair. She did not apologize for being late. She made no inquiry as to his neuralgia. On the other hand, she was not cross. She was just neutral, polite, cheerful, and apparently conscious of perfection. He strongly desired to inform her of the exact time of day, but his lips would not articulate the words. "Maud," she said with divine calm to the maid who bore in the baked York ham under its silver canopy, "you haven't taken away that brush that's in the passage." Another illustration of Nellie's inability to live up to £6,000 a year, she would always refer to the hall as the passage. "Plesm I did, Emma," replied Maud, now as conscious of perfection as her mistress. "He must have took it back again." "Who's he?" demanded the master. "Carlo, sir." Upon which triumph Maud retired. Edward Henry was dashed. Nevertheless, he quickly recovered his presence of mind, and sought about for a justification of his previous verdict upon the negligence of 5 women. "It would have been easy enough to put the brush where the dog couldn't get at it," he said. But he said this strictly to himself. He could not say it aloud. Nor could he say aloud the words, "neuralgia, £341, any more than he could say "late." That he was in a peculiar mental condition is proved by the fact that he did not remark the absence of his mother until he was putting her share of baked ham onto a plate. He thought, "This is a bit thick, this is," meaning the extreme lateness of his mother for the meal. But his only audible remark was a somewhat impatient banging down of the hot plate in front of his mother's empty chair. In answer to this banging, Nellie quietly began, "Your mother." He knew instantly then that Nellie was disturbed about something or other. Mother-in-law and daughter-in-law lived together under one roof in perfect amity. Nay, more, they often formed powerful and unscrupulous leagues against him. But whenever Nellie was disturbed by no matter what, she would say, "Your mother," instead of merely, "mother." It was an extraordinary subtle, silly, and effective way of putting him in the wrong. "Your mother is staying upstairs with Robert." Robert was the eldest child, aged 8. "Oh," breathed Edward Henry. He might have inquired what the nurse was for. He might have inquired how his mother meant to get her tea. But he refrained, adding simply, "What's up now?" And in retort to his wife's "you're," he laid a faint emphasis on the word "now," to imply that those women were always inventing some fresh imaginary woe for the children. "Carlo's bitten him in the calf," said Nellie, tightening her lips. This, at any rate, was not imaginary. "The kid was teasing him as usual, I suppose," he suggested. "That I don't know," said Nellie. "But I know we must get rid of that dog." "Serious?" "Of course we must," Nellie insisted, with an inadvertent heat, which she immediately cooled. "I mean the bite." "Well, it's a bite right enough." "And you're thinking of hydrophobia, death amid horrible agony and so on." "No, I'm not," she said stoutly, trying to smile. But he knew she was. And he knew also that the bite was a trifle. If it had been a good bite, she would have made it enormous. She would have hinted that the dog had left a chasm in the boy's flesh. "Yes, you are," he continued to twitter, encouraged by her attempt at a smile. However, the smile expired. "I suppose you won't deny that Carlo's teeth may have been dirty? He's always nosing in some filth or other," she said challengingly in a measured tone of sagacity. "And there may be blood poisoning." "Blood fiddlesticks," exclaimed Edward Henry. Such a nonsensical and infantile rejoinder deserved no answer, and it received none. Shortly afterwards, Maud entered and whispered that Nellie was wanted upstairs. As soon as his wife had gone, Edward Henry rang the bell. "Maud," he said, "bring me the signal out of my left-hand overcoat pocket." And he defiantly finished his meal at leisure, with the news of the day propped up against the flower pot, which he had set before him instead of the dish of ham. 3. Later, catching through the open door fragments of a conversation on the stairs which indicated that his mother was at last coming down for tea, he sped like a threatened delinquent into the drawing room. He had no wish to encounter his mother, though that woman usually said little. The drawing room, after the bathroom, was Edward Henry's favorite district in the home. Since he could not spend the whole of his time in the bathroom, and he could not, he wisely gave a special care to the drawing room, and he loved it as one always loves that upon which one has bestowed benefits. He was proud of the drawing room, and he had the right to be. The principal object in it, at night, was the electric chandelier, which would have been adequate for a lighthouse. Edward Henry's eyes were not what they used to be, and the minor advertisements in the Signal, which constituted his sole evening perusals, often lacked legibility. Edward Henry sincerely believed in light and heat. He was almost the only person in the Five Towns who did. In the Five Towns, people have fires in their grates, not to warm the room but to make the room bright. Seemingly, they use their pride to keep themselves warm. At any rate, whenever Edward Henry talked to them of radiators, they would sternly reply that a radiator did not and could not brighten a room. Edward Henry had made the great discovery that an efficient chandelier will brighten a room better even than a fire, and he had gilded his radiator. The notion of gilding the radiator was not his own. He had seen a gilded radiator in the newest hotel at Birmingham, and had rejoiced as some peculiar souls rejoice when they meet a fine line in a new poem. In concession to popular prejudice, Edward Henry had fire grates in his house, and fires therein during exceptionally frosty weather, but this did not save him from being regarded in the Five Towns as in some ways a peculiar soul. The effulgent source of dark heat was scientifically situated in front of the window, and on ordinarily cold evenings, Edward Henry and his wife and mother, and an acquaintance if one happened to come in, would gather round the radiator and play bridge or dummy whist. The other phenomena of the drawing room, which particularly interested Edward Henry, were the Turkey carpet, the four vast easy chairs, the sofa, the imposing cigar cabinet, and the mechanical piano player. At one brief period, he had hovered a good deal about the revolving bookcase containing the encyclopedia, to which his collection of books was limited, but the frail passion for literature had not survived a struggle with the seductions of the mechanical piano player. The walls of the room never drew his notice. He had chosen some years before a patent washable kind of wallpaper, which could be wiped over with a damp cloth, and he had also chosen the pattern of the paper, but it is a fact that he could spend hours in any room without even seeing the pattern of its paper. In the same way, his wife's cushions and little draperies and bows were invisible to him, though he had searched for and duly obtained the perfect quality of swansdown which filled the cushions. The one ornament of the walls which attracted him was a large and splendidly framed oil painting of a ruined castle in the midst of a somber forest through which cows were strolling. In the tower of the castle was a clock, and this clock was a realistic timepiece whose fingers moved and told the hour. Two of the oriel windows of the castle were realistic holes in its masonry. Through one of them you could put a key to wind up the clock, and through the other you could put a key to wind up the secret musical box, which played 16 different tunes. He had bought this handsome relic of the Victorian era, not less artistic, despite your scorn, than many devices for satisfying the higher instincts of the present day, at an auction sale in the Strand, London. But it, too, had been supplanted in his esteem by the mechanical piano player. He now selected an example of the most expensive cigar in the cigar cabinet and lighted it, as only a connoisseur can light a cigar, lovingly. He blew out the match lingeringly, with regret, and dropped it and the cigar's red collar with care into a large copper bowl on the center table, instead of flinging it against the Japanese umbrella in the fireplace. A grave disadvantage of radiators is that you cannot throw odds and ends into them. He chose the most expensive cigar because he wanted comfort and peace. The ham was not digesting very well. Then he sat down and applied himself to the property advertisements in the Signal, a form of sensational serial which usually enthralled him, but not tonight. He allowed the paper to lapse onto the floor, and then rose impatiently, rearranged the thick dark blue curtains behind the radiator, and finally yielded to the silent call of the mechanical piano player. He quite knew that to dally with the piano player while smoking a high-class cigar was to insult the cigar. But he did not care. He tilted the cigar upwards from an extreme corner of his mouth, and through the celestial smoke gazed at the titles of the new music rolls which had been delivered that day, and which were ranged on the top of the piano itself. And while he did so, he was thinking, why in thunder didn't the little thing come and tell me at once about that kid and his dog Bite? I wonder why she didn't. She seemed only to mention it by accident. I wonder why she didn't bounce into the bathroom and tell me at once. But it was untrue that he sought vainly for an answer to this riddle. He was aware of the answer. He even kept saying over the answer to himself, she's made up her mind. I've been teasing her a bit too much lately about those kids and their precious illnesses. And she's doing the dignified. That's what she's doing. She's doing the dignified. Of course, instantly after his tea, he ought to have gone upstairs to inspect the wounded victim of dogs. The victim was his own child, and its mother was his wife. He knew that he ought to have gone upstairs long since. He knew that he ought now to go, and the sooner the better. But somehow he could not go, he could not bring himself to go. In the minor and major crises of married life, there are not two partners, but four. Each partner has a dual personality. Each partner is indeed two different persons, and one of these fights against the other with the common result of a fatal inaction. The wickeder of the opposing persons in Edward Henry, getting the upper hand of the more virtuous, sniggered. Dirty teeth indeed. Blood poisoning indeed. Why not rabies while she's about it? I guarantee she's dreaming of coffins and mourning coaches already. Scanning nonchalantly the titles of the music rolls, he suddenly saw, Funeral March. Chopin. She shall have it, he said, affixing the roll to the mechanism. And added, whatever it is. for he was not acquainted with the funeral march from Chopin's pianoforte sonata. His musical education had, in truth, begun only a year earlier, with the advertisements of the Pianisto mechanical player. He was a judge of advertisements, and the Pianisto literature pleased him in a high degree. He justifiably reckoned that he could distinguish between honest and dishonest advertising. He made a deep study of the question of mechanical players, and deliberately came to the conclusion that the Pianisto was the best. It was also the most costly. But one of the conveniences of having £6,000 a year is that you need not deny yourself the best mechanical player because it happens to be the most costly. He bought a Pianisto, and incidentally, he bought a superb grand piano and exiled the old cottage piano to the nursery. The Pianisto was the best, partly because, like the vacuum cleaner, it could be operated by electricity, and partly because by means of certain curved lines on the unrolling paper and of certain gunmetal levers and clutches, it enabled the operator to put his secret ardent soul into the music. Assuredly, it had given Edward Henry a taste for music. The whole world of musical compositions was his to conquer, and he conquered it at the rate of about 2 great masters a month. From Handel to Richard Strauss, even from Palestrina to Debussy, the achievements of genius lay at his mercy. He criticized them with a freedom that was entirely unprejudiced by tradition. Beethoven was no more to him than Arthur Sullivan, indeed, was rather less. The works of his choice were the Tannhauser Overture, a potpourri of Verdi's Ida, Chopin's Study in Thirds, which ravished him, and a selection from The Merry Widow, which also ravished him. So that on the whole, it may be said that he had a very good natural taste. He at once liked Chopin's funeral march. He entered profoundly into the spirit of it. With the gunmetal levers, he produced in a marvelous fashion the long tragic roll of the drums, and by the manipulation of a clutch, he distilled into the chant at the graveside a melancholy sweetness that rent the heart. The later crescendos were overwhelming. And as he played there, with the bright blaze of the chandelier on his fair hair and beard, and the blue cigar smoke in his nostrils, and the effluence of the gilded radiator behind him, and the intimacy of the drawn window curtains and the closed and curtained door folding him in from the world, and the agony of the music grieving his artistic soul to the core, as he played there, he grew gradually happier and happier, and the zest of existence seemed to return. It was not only that he felt the elemental, unfathomable satisfaction of a male who is sheltered in solitude from a pack of women that have got on his nerves. There was also the more piquant assurance that he was behaving in a very sprightly manner. How long was it since he had accomplished anything worthy of his ancient reputation as a card, as the card of the Five Towns? He could not say. But now he knew that he was being a card again. The whole town would smile and forgive and admire if it learnt that. Nellie invaded the room. She had resumed the affray. "Denry," she reproached him in an uncontrolled voice. "I'm ashamed of you. I really am." She was no longer doing the dignified. The mask was off, and the unmistakable lineaments of the outraged mother appeared. That she should address him as Denry proved the intensity of her agitation. Years ago, when he had been made an alderman, his wife and his mother had decided that Denry was no longer a suitable name for him, and had abandoned it in favor of Edward Henry. He ceased playing. "Why," he protested, with a ridiculous air of innocence. "I'm only playing Chopin. Can't I play Chopin?" He was rather surprised and impressed that she had recognized the piece for what it was. But of course she did, as a fact, know something about music, he remembered, though she never touched the Pianisto. "I think it's a pity you can't choose some other evening for your funeral marches," she exclaimed. "If that's it," said Edward Henry like lightning, "why did you stick me out? You weren't afraid of hydrophobia." "I'll thank you to come upstairs," she replied with warmth. "Oh, all right, my dear." "All right," he cooed, and they went upstairs in a rather solemn procession. 4. Nellie led the way to the chamber known as Maisie's room, where the youngest of the Matchins was wont.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.